Hello, this is Nice Wanderer, and you're watching The Nowman Show. Joining us today is the award-winning documentary filmmaker, musician, and journalist, Morgan Neville. He's an Academy Award-winning filmmaker who has been making films for over 20 years. He's covered art and historical events, but he's best known for his documentaries about music, including films about the Rolling Stones, Keith Richards, Stax Records, and the Memphis Soul, Muddy Waters, Johnny Cash, Hank Williams, Iggy Pop, and he even won an Academy Award in 2014 for his documentary called 20 Feet From Stardom, which is about backup singers. The Music of Strangers opened last summer after playing in festivals such as Tribeca and Berlinale, and features cellist Yo-Yo Ma and the Silk Road Ensemble. Morgan Neville, thank you for being on the Nowman Show.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
My pleasure. Now, you started basically as a journalist. You went to school and studied journalism, correct?
Well, not quite. I went to the University of Pennsylvania. My great loves were filmmaking, journalism, and music. And I could not major in any of those three things at the University of Pennsylvania.
Wow.
I'm not sure why I went there, even though I loved it. So I became, a history major,
which
is something I love. I ended up studying colonial American history of all things.
Yeah. Wow.
But these loves of mine, I still wrote for the school paper, I still played in bands, and I still watched every movie I could. And I finally, after a few years of working as a journalist, found my way to documentary as a way of kind of taking all three of those things and putting them together at the same time. But on my way to becoming a filmmaker, I did spend a number of years as a journalist, including at KPFA in Berkeley. We were talking about that.
Yeah, Pacifica Radio Network.
Yeah, and I really think of documentary filmmaking as 3D journalism anyway. I think it's great training. It's basically narrative storytelling, interviewing, talking to people, and trying to figure out what's important about their lives and how we frame that.
And being a musician, for a second, going back to that, when did you start playing music?
I mean, I started playing piano when I was a kid. Then I think I formed my first band when I was 12.
Wow.
And
what kind of music was it?
I mean, bad.
Really bad music.
Bad music.
I hear you.
It was some version of somewhere between, the Monkees and the Sex Pistols. I think
my brother and I, when we made music, it was a cross between Frank Zappa and who knows what, you know?
Yeah, we weren't even good enough to sound like bad Frank Zappa.
So, yeah, exactly.
I ended up playing in every type of band imaginable. And as you see from the music films I've made, music goes in every imaginable direction.
Yes.
I mean, that's what I love about it. And people sometimes say to me, don't music films feel limiting? And to me, it's the opposite.
Yes.
Because music is a Trojan horse or a way into any kind of story you want to tell. If you want to tell a story about Memphis in the 1960s,
exactly,
or a story about Europe in the 1800s, music can take you there. You know, it's kind of an amazing filmic vehicle to use to tell a bigger story.
So when you first started getting into film, after school and after working as a journalist, you also worked at The Nation for a bit. That was a way for you to be able to combine all these different things together that you were interested in and do it in one job. Right?
Yeah, my first documentary was called Shotgun Freeway, Drives Through Lost L.A.
What's that about?
you have no idea from the title, do you? So I grew up in Southern California. Mm-hmm. My mom grew up just down the street from here.
Oh, really?
Wow. Yep, in San Marino. And,
wow.
And I went to kindergarten here in Pasadena.
Oh, you did?
And then I moved away and I lived back east for school and for working as a journalist. And I think I had a big chip on my shoulder about the idea that Southern California had culture and history.
To say
LA history at that time was an oxymoron.
Yes.
People would laugh at you that was a punchline of a joke. And so I just had this idea that I really wanted to try and capture what history meant in a city like Los Angeles. And it was right around the time that Mike Davis put out City of Quartz and James Elroy was just getting some traction. And so they're both in my documentary, and Joan Didion and a lot of Angelenos talking about what their version of LA history is. And it was a crazy Mondo idea. But I also thought it was going to take me 3 months, and it took me 3 years.
Yes.
But that's a a good lesson for any aspiring documentary filmmaker.
Yes.
You multiply it by 10, at least. But the thing I realized, and I actually called my parents 2 weeks after I started the documentary, and I said, oh, this is what I'm gonna do for the rest of my life. Like, I instantly knew that this was kind of everything I liked doing rolled into one package. And I've been doing it now for 23 years.
Wow, that's amazing. So now, you, of course, did an Academy Award-winning film, and we're going to talk about that, of course. But you received 3 Grammy nominations for the soundtracks of 3 of the films. One was called Muddy Waters Can't Be Satisfied. I saw him make his comeback when he warmed up for Eric Clapton on my 21st birthday, actually. I had to put that in there. Respect Yourself, the Stax Records Story, and Johnny Cash's America. And I saw Johnny at the end of his live career. Let's watch a trailer right now of Respect Yourself.
Otis became that power pack, raw, gutsy, emotional, serious performer. I mean, you felt him, you heard the tear in his voice.
I've been loving you.
He said, well, they're all gone. I said, what do you mean gone? He said, they're gone. They all went in the lake of Wisconsin.
And I hollered to them, call an ambulance on your police radio. They said, where did the shot come from? So that's where the picture comes, with us pointing to the building across the street.
After Dr. King was killed, it got pretty intense around there.
They lost their families. One person committed suicide.
But sometimes growth and ambition can wreck a company.
But Dr. King had been killed, and we needed some sense of joy, some sense of strength.
I know the film talks about the history of Stax, but it was really the death of Otis Redding and then Dr. Martin Luther King, which was right down the street, right from the studio. Mm-hmm. And how did that change Stax going forward from that point?
Well, it changed everything. And for people who may or may not know what Stax is, everybody knows the music. I mean, it's Otis Redding, Sam and Dave, Booker T and the MGs,
Staple
the Staple Singers.
Singers.
I mean, the most amazing Memphis soul music of all time. And what was so unique about it was the label was really a coming together of white people and black people.
Yes.
In a city where that did not happen.
Yes.
Absolutely not. And a number of events happened in 1967 that really transformed America and Stax. One of them was the assassination of Martin Luther King just down the street from Stax at the Lorraine Hotel, which was the one place where black people and white people could swim together. Songwriters at Stax would rent rooms to write songs in the motel there.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And Otis Redding's death in the winter of 67.
Mm-hmm.
And Stax was actually kind of reborn then as a black-owned business. The ownership changed. Al Bell took over the label, and it became this kind of new voice of black entrepreneurship and empowerment. And then it all goes horribly wrong. I mean, it's like a Greek tragedy of a story.
And even Atlantic Records, right, came in and somehow legally acquired the rights to all that music or something?
There were some contract shenanigans that actually ended up depriving Stax of all of their early masters.
Yeah.
But this is what I love about music films, is that even though you have incredible soundtracks and incredible singers and artists, it's a story about race and civil rights and a city and a time and a place. I mean, it gets into so many different dynamics of what's going on. And what you really have at Stax is a black-owned label that's now making a lot of money. Isaac Hayes
was
one of the biggest. He started as a kid in the neighborhood, literally a 14-year-old in the neighborhood who walked into the studio.
And wasn't he the first African-American composer to win an Oscar for best score?
Score for Shaft.
Yeah.
But as Stax got more and more power, more and more money, the powers that be in Memphis were not comfortable with a black-owned business having that much profile and that much money.
Wow.
And conspired, I would say, without being too conspiratorial about it.
Yeah.
I think it really contributed to the downfall of the label. So you have these incredible stories like that with an amazing soundtrack.
Yeah.
That is a, to do films like that, I could do that forever.
And Memphis is really an amazing place. There's so much history there and so much, you know, content.
I've made 3 documentaries in Memphis.
Wow.
Sam Phillips and Sun Records.
Yes, yes.
The other great Memphis label. Yeah. And Muddy Waters, which was largely based around the Delta and just up in Memphis. And I've worked a lot with a writer there, Robert Gordon, who's a great Memphis music writer. But it's such an interesting city because it's the crossroads of the North and the South and the East and the West.
Yes.
And it's the city that entire region of Middle America that everybody went to.
Yes.
You know, if you had talent within 300 miles, 500 miles, 1,000 miles, you would go to Memphis. And that's how B.B. King and Helen Wolf and Johnny Cash and Elvis Presley all found their way to
Lewis,
Memphis. Jerry Lee Lewis, you can go on and on and on.
Yeah.
But it was the Mecca for people who wanted to make it, but also not make it in a commercial sense, make it in a, though they wanted that, but that it was a city that respected weirdness,
for
lack of a better word.
That's right.
You know, individuality, I think, is the better word for it. That's something that Sam Phillips and Stax Records were evangelical about, the idea about having your own sound, your own voice, and doing something unique.
And then, I have special memories of being there myself, Jerry Lee Lewis's ranch, actually, in Nesbitt.
Yeah.
I'll talk to you about that some other time. It's an interesting story going out into the sticks. I mean, when you cross over the state line, it's a whole different world, right?
It is, interesting. But, you know, where else are you going to find a home for somebody like Jerry Lee Lewis or Helen Wolf?
Yeah.
And these are unique characters, if there ever were unique American characters
in
the arts.
And very real, the real deal.
Yes.
They'll tell you exactly what's on their mind. Now, during 1998 to 2006, you did a lot of different, we'll stay on the subject of music for the moment, Brian Wilson, Sam Phillips, as you mentioned. There's Songwriters Connection, Burt Bacharach, Bobby Darin, Neil Diamond, Carole King, Neil Sedaka. There's American Masters with Hank Williams, you know, Hairdos and Heartache, the Women of Country Music. I love that name, Hairdos and Heartache. Ray Charles and the Hitmakers, teens that made pop music. We forget about that. A lot of teens did.
Yeah.
Michael Jackson was a teen, you know, Donny Osmond. Nat King Cole, the Highwaymen. So many.
I know, when you actually list them out like that, it sounds a little schizophrenic. And somebody once said to me, you're dabbling in all these different types of music.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, like why you shouldn't, you shouldn't be doing that.
You know,
and I'd say, well, who on their, their playlist or in their CD collection or wherever you listen to your music on your Spotify, only listens to one kind of music.
That's right.
I mean, I think we all listen to all kinds of music.
That's right.
And for me, often the music is me being able to explore a part of the culture I didn't necessarily know before, too. A lot of it was music I loved, but a lot of it was music I discovered, too.
That's right.
And there's something I love about, particularly as much as I love artists, I love songwriters and producers, people that are the writers that come up with the vision. A film like Hitmakers was a documentary I made with Carole King. And it was about the Brill Building, which some people know.
Yes, with Jerry Goffin and all the...
So, you know, there are all these legendary songwriting teams. Carole King and Jerry Goffin, Lieber and Stoller, Bacharach and David, Greenwich and Barry, and Man
Neil
and Wild.
Diamond work out of that?
And came in at the tail end.
Yeah,
you know, a lot of people passed through there. And they were basically, it was like Tin Pan Alley, writing the new hit for Bobby Darin or Bobby V or whoever came in that day.
Yeah,
and but something about people, and they were all under the age of 25.
Yes,
that's
exactly
the other
right.
crazy thing.
Yeah, I know.
But something about people working in that way, or producers working in the studio that way, that I find really interesting. It's also a challenge as a filmmaker to do stories about things that happen behind closed doors. But what you get out of that is you get this reference point to things you know, songs you know, and you get to understand what made them what they are, and you understand them in a new way. You know, songs like one of my favorite stories that I discovered and put into that documentary was the song Save the Last Dance for Me.
Oh, wow.
great song by Doc Pomus and Mort Schumann. And Doc Pomus, some people know he wrote Viva Las Vegas and a lot of other famous songs. But he was a kind of heavyweight, paraplegic, old blues belter from Brooklyn. When he got married, he was not able to dance with his wife because at that point he was on braces and crutches and couldn't dance. And on his wedding invitation, he wrote the words, "Save the last dance for me."
Wow.
And he later took those lyrics and turned them into that amazing Drifter song.
Wow.
But when you realize what that song's really about is a man who's unable to actually dance with his wife on his wedding day and thinking, now I'm here for the long haul. You know, we're going to have this forever. And it just makes you hear that song in a whole new way. I mean, whenever you can have that experience, when you transform something that's familiar and make you listen to it in a different way. I mean, that...
And you realize the personal story that was behind it. It has a whole new meaning to it.
Absolutely.
You know, now, in 2014, you actually won the Academy Award for Best Documentary of a film called 20 Feet from Stardom, about extremely talented singers that were like Judith Hill, Claudia Lennear. Lennear, I'm sorry.
Sure.
Tate Vega, of course, Mary Clayton, and Darlene Love.
Sure.
What was it like working with well, before we talk about the film, let's watch a clip.
Sure.
Singing background remains a somewhat unheralded position, you know.
There's a power to these women that stand on stage with these guys.
It's a bit of a walk. That walk to the front is complicated.
Can you turn off the radio?
How could you logically not have a diva have her music on? I don't get that.
The rock and roll people like Bruce and Elton John and Stevie wanted to know who that girl singer was. My life has been all about trying to make a success of the gift that I had.
She was like the really hot one of the iCats. She was very hot, beautiful girl.
I don't set out to be the sex symbol.
But you post in Playboy.
My greatest pleasure is to stand back and let them do what they can do.
When you're a background singer, it is a springboard, but it can easily become quicksand if that's not what you want to do.
There's no guarantees in entertainment. I've got dreams.
Rough dreams.
I felt like if I just gave my heart to what I was doing, I would automatically be a star.
It got so bad, I started cleaning houses. And I just looked up and said, okay, you're supposed to be singing. There's a whole world out there who wants to hear you sing.
They're in the game and they stayed in the game, and they're legends.
It is my honor to induct into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and about time to Miss Darlene Love.
What was the real story behind what inspired the creation of that movie? Can you tell us?
Sure. The real story. The idea belonged to Gil Friesen.
The producer.
And Gil had been the president of A&M Records for a number of years. And the story he told me the day I met him was that he had recently gone to a Leonard Cohen concert and had smoked a joint and had spent the entire concert fixated on the three amazing backup singers.
Yeah.
And if you've ever seen Leonard Cohen, you know he has amazing backup singers and he features them in incredible ways and just uses them. And Gil said he spent the whole concert thinking, what's their story? And he said when he woke up the next day, the thought was still in his head. You know, what are their lives like? And he said, so this is my idea. Let's make a documentary about backup singers. And I said, that's really interesting because as much music as I know and as many music documentaries as I'd made, I didn't really know much about backup singers. And I said, well, what do you think the film is? And he said, well, that's your job.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it was just kind of jumping off the cliff and hoping that we found something. And there were no books to read. There was no way to research it other than to just talk to backup singers. And we ended up doing maybe 80 interviews with backup singers.
Wow.
And figured out how it worked. I mean, it's a very tiny community of people.
Yes, yes.
And they're the most amazing artists. I mean, to be a backup singer, you have to be the best of the best because you're working without a safety net. You're walking into a different session and you don't know if you're singing, you know, rock and roll or opera practically.
Yeah, and these are people that grew up, you know, as I did, like in church. So you get a lot of your education, your music education in church. So yeah. I understand the harmonies, the melody, and all of that stuff. And these women, I mean, the amount of work that they did amongst all of them, like for instance, Claudia Lennear, you know, actually dated David Bowie for a while, and she was the inspiration for Lady Grinning Soul. Then you have Tate Vega, who, you know, has worked with Elton John and Leon Russell, mm-hmm. even did that backups on that Union album mm-hmm. that they did together. And there's Mary Clayton, of course, who did that infamous Gimme Shelter, you know, and because of that, she did the Feeling All Right with Joe mm-hmm. Cocker. She did Sweet Home Alabama with Leonard Skinner. I mean, it just goes on and on. And then, of course, you know, Darlene Love, who was, yeah. I've interviewed Danny Tedesco, yeah. the Wrecking mm-hmm. Crew film, so she was part of that story, too, with the Crystals, and she was even in the Blossoms, mm-hmm. which I talked to Don Randy about, the keyboard player, and of course, you know, for years she was on the Phil Spector Christmas album. She did the David Letterman show every Christmas. Mm-hmm. I mean, just so many interesting stories and interesting people, and that's just the tip of the iceberg.
Yeah, but at the same time, invisible.
I mean, yes, I know.
This is the thing that, and we were talking about earlier about hearing something different in something you know. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And when I first started thinking about this film, I mean, I think I literally sat down that night and said, okay, well, let me just think of songs with great backup vocals.
Yeah, yeah.
And I had a hard time coming up with five
yeah.
or 10.
Yeah, yeah.
Because your brain does not think of them that
yeah,
way.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
exactly.
And nobody ever thinks about it that way. And so I went through my record collection. I had the radio on. I mean, for the couple of years I was making the film, I was keeping a running list. I'd hear a song on the radio and go, oh my God, of course, that song has great backup vocals. But it's hard to think of those things unprompted. And
yeah, yeah.
But what it does is retrain your ear. I mean, now I always hear backup vocals, you know. I pick it out all the time. And then understanding that it's the same people who do this and this and this and this, and they do it because they're incredible artists. And really then kind of realizing what their journey was, many of them, like you said, from the church, but on their own kind of journeys through the Wild West of the music business and everything else, and how they all come out on the other side. So it became a spiritual journey, even though I didn't know what it was going to be going into it.
How did you get down? I mean, the stars of the movie, mm-hmm. The stars of this movie basically are the women that I mentioned. I also didn't mm-hmm. mention Judith Hill, who actually was on yeah. with Prince when he had to do the emergency landing a week mm-hmm. before he passed, and he produced her album. What was it that made you decide to make these basically, I mean, you obviously have to pick stars mm-hmm. for the film because mm-hmm. there's so many people you could have put
in
this film.
Well, like I said, we interviewed 80
yeah.
backup singers.
How did you
singers.
Narrow it down to that
I mean, it was
group.
Difficult because I think I was looking for a group of women that represented different generations of backup mm-hmm. singers mm-hmm. who had great success, who had sung on well-known songs, but who had made different decisions or had different things happen to them throughout their careers.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That was incredibly hard to find that group of characters, so it all kind of fit together like a puzzle. And, you know, I think there were certain people, somebody like Darlene Love. I mean, she was one of the first people I interviewed.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
I remember turning to Gil,
yeah.
Gil the moment I finished the interview and said, well, we could always make a Darlene Love documentary.
Right,
like,
right.
She was so great.
Incredible
Her story,
story
was so big. I just
know.
Said, okay, well, you know, we have something. We have a
right.
film,
right,
you know,
right.
and let's keep building. But then people like, you know, Mary Clayton, who's a force of nature, and you know, playing her the "Give Me Shelter"
yes.
Isolated backup audio track of her singing. That was another one of those moments where I just said, "Oh my God, that was incredible." Oh no, now I have to clear a Rolling Stones song.
Yeah,
you know,
but it was amazing.
Yeah.
And we'll continue this conversation in part two of the interview with Morgan Neville, and you're watching The Now Man Show. This is Nice Wander.
We're getting ready to change the world, so stay tuned.
I'd like to read a book, but a song that has a hook.
Hello, this is Nice Wander of the Now Man Show, and I'm here with Academy Award winning director, producer, and writer Morgan Neville. Welcome back.
Thank you.
We're continuing our conversation from last time we ended, talking about actually the Academy Award winning film, which is 20 Feet From Stardom. There's just so many stories that we could go into about this. What else can you say about that film?
Let me maybe just tell you about the experience of taking the film out in the world. It's one thing
to
make the
film.
Yeah,
that sounds great.
It was such a crazy ride, because when you make a film, you kind of hope that your parents are going to like it.
Yeah, right,
or something,
exactly,
you know?
Yeah.
Your expectations are very low.
Yeah.
And certainly when I showed up to interview all these women, they didn't think the film was going to go where it went. You know, they thought, oh yeah, you're another guy with a camera who's... Mm-hmm. You know, it'll end up on YouTube somewhere.
We've seen it 100
times.
And yeah.
But there was something about the film. I mean, we put it together and we were really happy with it. But I didn't show it to any of the women in the film. And opening night at the Sundance Film Festival, we had the opening night film.
Wow.
And the women were there, and there was a packed house. We'd never shown it to more than five or 10 people at a time.
Wow.
And there was just an incredible kind of spiritual experience happening in the screen that I've never had before.
Amazing.
It was one of those kind of once in a lifetime experiences. And then the women of the film came out, and it was just charged, you know, and they started singing, and it just became this roller coaster that we were on for more than a year, from Sundance to the Academy Awards.
Wow.
But the best part is that you don't expect your film to really be that transformative.
Yes.
But it changed everybody's life. And the thing I'm so grateful for is how it changed the lives of the women who were in the film. And people like Claudia is singing again. She wasn't singing at the time. Lisa Fisher has her own band and she's touring the world.
Great.
Playing in jazz festivals and jazz clubs, doing exactly what she should be doing.
Exactly.
And Darlene's been doing better than ever. And Mary Clayton, was in a car accident, and she's getting better. I've told she's gathering her plans for her kind of reemergence.
That's great, because she even was able to do the Coldplay album.
Yeah, she did a song on the Coldplay album. And Judith Hill, as you mentioned before, did an album with that Prince produced. And I actually had the opportunity, Judith called me to go out and film something with her at Paisley Park. This is about a year and a half ago.
Yeah.
And there's no way you can turn down an invitation like that.
That's right.
Paisley Park is like...
I've almost gone. I almost went one time and I didn't go.
But yeah, you feel like you're getting the ticket to Willy Wonka's factory or something.
Right.
So,
that's a good way to put it.
Yes,
that.
I'll be there.
yeah.
And we had the full Prince experience. And and Judith, I think the album was great. And I was really happy for her. And then I just, you know, we're still in touch. She's actually local here in Pasadena. So Judith Hill, so you might want to talk to her sometime.
Yeah, that would be fantastic.
You know, because she has a great story too, and comes from a great musical family.
I'm already interested. And I'm a huge Prince fan too. And actually, had a show one night in a club that he played, and I had to stop mine, and so I knew Power Generation could play. It was amazing. Because you know, when you play a small club, you don't play. I don't have to play the hits here. I can play whatever I want, and that's exactly what we got. Great memory for me. Now, you also have a lot of we're briefly going to go into the non-musical part, because there's some interesting stuff here too, so let's get right into this. You were also made movies at the beginning, you know, with Sidney Poitier, Gloria Swanson, the Houston family was, you know, and there was The Joy of Lex, that TV movie that Henry Rollins is in.
Yes.
Can you just briefly tell us what that was?
It was a crazy idea, and it turned out great. It's a documentary about lexicography.
What is that?
Words.
Words, really?
Yes.
So, I learned a new word.
Yes. So it's about, as we said, it was a movie about words and the people that use them.
Wow, interesting.
It's just, where do words come from? How do we invent them? How was language used? You know, it was kind of a crazy idea.
Was that the poet in you that made you want to make that film?
Yeah, but I'm also like a crossword nut. And
oh, really?
Wow. You know, I love words. So it just was one of those crazy ideas that we did and was great. You know, it's, you know, when I think about what unifies my films, it's that they're all about culture,
yes,
in a way.
Yeah.
Language, I've made art films,
yeah,
and even a film like Best of Enemies with Gore Vidal and William,
yes,
F. Buckley is really,
yes,
a film about media or a film about the culture of politics.
We definitely want to get into that towards the end here. And you did the Cool School.
Yeah, the Cool School.
And that was about the Ferris Gallery, right?
Exactly.
What was that for those that may not know here?
For
in
those
Los
that
Angeles?
Don't know, and actually Pastina has a good role in this film,
really? Yeah,
too.
Really? Yeah, that's right.
That the Ferris Gallery was the first real modern art gallery in Los Angeles. And that first generation of great LA artists came out of that gallery. That's Ed Ruscha, Robert Irwin, Billy L. Bengston, Ken Price, Larry Bell, Ed Keenholz. And it was also the gallery that first showed Warhol.
Oh, yeah.
The Soup Can Show premiered here in LA, not in New York.
And Duchamp, too, right?
Marcel Duchamp. So the founder of the Ferris Gallery, a legendary curator named Walter Hopps, left the Ferris Gallery and took over the Pasadena Museum of Art.
Which became
the Norton Simon.
Yeah,
So the first pop art show in the world happened here in Pasadena.
Really?
Yes. It was called New Paintings of Common Objects. And it was the first museum show that Andy Warhol or Ed Ruscha or Roy Lichtenstein was ever in.
Wow.
And it happened right here.
Wow. See, a lot of people don't probably know that history. You know, and then let's watch a clip.
In the 1920s, Italian immigrant Simon Rodia started to build a series of spires in his Watts backyard. He said he wanted to build something beautiful as a tribute to his adopted city, so he made the towers from what he found around him. Garbage. The job took him 33 years, and after he completed it, he handed the deed to a neighbor and vanished, never to return. In the wake of World War II, a new generation of renegade artists decided to stay in LA and make a go of it. Choosing to ignore the art history that New York dictated, they looked around to the ugly boulevards, automobile graveyards, the flashy billboards, to find inspiration and called it art. The place where they found each other was called Ferris.
There is this tendency out here just to not care about art history, but it's because we're a young city. We're not an old city. We're not surrounded by art. We don't have to deal with our past because there is no past.
Even though we didn't have enough evidence, we were completely confident that we were on the right track and everybody else was full of shit, you know?
The work that was going on here in the early 60s was as important as any work being made anywhere in the world.
Yeah, we got something that's different out here and we can compete with New York. And that's cultural ambition. They had a pool of interesting artists and something was percolating. And then you got the spark, the Ferris Gallery.
You did a film with an interesting artist whose name was Wayne
White.
White.
Yes.
And it's called Beauty is Embarrassing. Mm-hmm. Well, let's go ahead and watch a clip about this guy. And if you don't know who this guy is, you'll know just by watching this clip, and we'll be back and talk about it.
This humble room is my studio. These are drawings from the first season of Pee-wee's Playhouse. I designed most of the puppets on the show. Here's my man, Dirty Dog. I wanted him to have this butt hanging out of his mouth that they wouldn't let us. It's a kid's show.
But I became Randy.
Yeah, smoking's cool, Pee-wee.
This is a prop from the Smashing Pumpkins video. Whoa! This is Peter Gabriel, big time video. This is what happens when you get all proud of yourself and you're polishing your Emmy. Well, I've worn a lot of different hats. Painter, sculptor, cartoonist, puppeteer, set designer, art director, animator, illustrator.
Kids mainlined it. He was imprinting their brain, and they don't even know it.
The little Zach Galifianakis, the little Snuffy Smith, the little Unabomber.
Wayne has touched people in ways that they don't even know.
My mission is to bring humor into fine art. Ladies and gentlemen, the world's largest George Jones head.
I think when you're an artist, you want to put your stuff out there just because of the exuberance of being creative, and then you feel bad about yourself. So I see that in Wayne's work.
Beauty is embarrassing.
It's beautiful out here. It's so beautiful, it hurts my feelings.
I saw Wayne's first New York show, and I was astonished. It really just blew me away, and I had to find out more about it and him.
This is called Sexy Paintings by Sexy Painters for Sexy People. And I always love that there's a little teeny ghost of the red underpaintings. There's nothing amateurish about anything that he does.
I learned that art could be a 24/7 lifestyle. I learned that art could be fun.
I've been trying to make beauty my whole life.
If this can work, there's hope for us all.
I want to try everything I can. You know, I want to take this painting idea and see if you can do a puppet version of it. I want to take the cartooning and turn it into a set. I want to take the set and turn it back into a painting.
That's a true pioneer. That's a person who is never satisfied, always wants to know, how do I understand myself more?
Ladies and gentlemen, Wayne White.
Do what you love. It's going to lead to where you want to go.
How did you decide to make a film about him? He's such an interesting character.
Yeah, well, Neil Berkeley had come up with the idea to make the film and made it. I helped produce it with him and worked on it. Because these are stories I love, you know, stories about... creative people using their art to understand the world. You know, I think it's something we're all kind of engaging in. And something about Wayne, even though he's, as you can see, a very unique individual with a very unique kind of taste, he's very relatable too.
Yes.
I think he's not a rock star or a world famous artist.
Right.
He's a working artist.
Yes.
You know, he's one of us.
Yes.
Like a backup singer,
yep.
You know, one of us. You know, we're
That's
all
right.
kind of trying to do the best and balancing art and craft and commerce and all these other things, trying to use our skills for what we can do with them.
That's right.
And Wayne is just inspirational because he's because he can find the fun thing inside of almost any moment.
I know.
You know, and that's kind of his gift, is able to kind of turn something very mundane into something very humorous or funny or absurd, and I love absurdity, and Wayne embodies that.
He embodies that, and he's so real, because, you know, the last quote, the very last thing that we hear in that trailer, he says, "Do what you love, it's going to lead you to where you want to go." I mean, there's something very spiritual in that, mm-hmm. as well as quirky, and, you know, I just resonate with that so much, you know what I mean? We need more people like this who are so expressive in so many ways. I mean, the way his brain works, I have to get him in here, too, and just how does this work? This is so fascinating. And there's a film that actually was in the shortlist at the Academy Awards this year, Best of Enemies, mm-hmm. Which basically you worked with the Muddy Waters producer on that as well.
Yeah, Robert Gordon.
Robert
and
Gordon.
I did it together.
And it's about the William F. Buckley and Gore Vidal debates. There were like 10 of them, right? Tell us about that. And well, actually, let's watch a clip and then we'll talk about it.
This
This is Miami Day One.
The Republicans decided to hold their convention south of the Mason-Dixon line. And I blew that one. Let's...
Pieces of the ceiling start flying, and then the whole thing started giving away.
To help us extract meaning from these conventions, two of America's most eloquent commentators, William Buckley and Gore Vidal.
Bill Buckley was the first modern conservative to see that ideological debates were cultural debates.
Mr. Buckley, do you think miniskirts are in good taste?
On you, I think they are.
The people at ABC asked him, well, is there anybody you wouldn't go on with? And he said, the only one I can think of is Gore Vidal.
Gore Vidal is one of America's most successful and distinguished writers.
We are all prostitutes in one sense or another, ethically, if not sexually.
For Buckley, Vidal was the devil.
I am a happy warrior. I'm in battle. I'm enjoying it.
He represented everything that was going to moral hell.
These were two visions of America clashing.
Each thought that the other was quite dangerous.
All this security makes me very nervous, because it's necessary, apparently.
If Buckley were not taken out, his ideas would take down the nation.
The country is being split at the seams.
It's almost as if they were matter and antimatter.
Say that again.
Freedom breeds inequality. Now say it a third time.
No, twice is enough.
He's always to the right and almost always in the wrong.
I confess that anything complicated confuses Mr. Vidal.
A grotesque example.
He's nothing feigned. They really do despise one another.
Now listen, you
right
here.
Stop calling me
a crypto-Nazi.
Let's stop calling names.
I'll slap you in your goddamn face, and you'll stay plastered. This is William F. Buckley, Jr. in New York.
Perfect.
So, Morgan, what was this film about in detail?
This film was about William F. Buckley and Gore Vidal, famous right-wing intellectual and famous left-wing intellectual, yeah. Who had a series of nationally televised debates in 1968. On top of that, they hated each other's guts.
yeah.
And they thought that these debates were going to help determine the future of the democracy.
Yeah.
So the stakes were high.
Yeah.
But what it really is a story about how media has changed. This
yes.
moment became, in a way, the template for pundit TV we have today.
That's right.
And something we're living in right now in the middle of an election season. So these were all the things I was thinking about. Personally, I've been fascinated with both characters. In fact, I used to work for Gore Vidal.
Oh, you did?
Yes, as a fact checker.
As a fact
yes,
checker?
Yes, so...
Wow, that must have been really interesting.
Yeah, it was horrible.
It was horrible? Oh, wow.
No, I mean, I have tremendous respect for Gore, and he was a great writer. My job was to tell him he'd gotten very small facts slightly wrong. And if you know anything about Gore Vidal,
yes.
you can imagine that he didn't enjoy mm-hmm. being told that. It was an educational experience.
Yeah, to say the least.
But making the film, was just really exciting for me because it got to talk about all these kinds of issues I'm interested in, which is how we talk with each other and where
yes.
we can find common ground. And whether that common ground comes from the difference from the front of the stage to the back of the stage, or through characters like Johnny Cash and Hank Williams, who are championed by people the left and the right. And,
exactly.
I'm always looking for those areas of commonality.
That's fantastic. There's a New York Times article that came out about the film, written by A.O. Scott.
Mm-hmm.
And I like this quote here. It says, "There's no doubt that the debates were a harbinger of cable news shouting matches to come as television journalism is transformed itself from democracy's buttoned-up super-eco into its snarling id." That's a pretty, to me, that's a compliment that you portrayed that exactly accurately.
Well, it's a compliment, but I'm unhappy that it's true.
I hear you.
That in a way, media should be mediating.
That's right.
What it should be doing.
That's right.
And in fact, it's become the opposite. It's become something that, again, divides us rather than unites us.
Exactly.
And these are things that I'm always focused on, because I come out of media and journalism myself, and I'm always looking and having real dialogue and looking for common
ground.
Yeah.
Exactly, and allowing all voices to be heard. You know, I think that's really important, not just focusing on one, but the full spectrum, which we're not always seeing these days.
And
right?
That's it's complicated because, you know, the democratization of media has also led, unfortunately, to the democratization of truth.
That's right.
So now, if we don't have to listen to a centralized media, which, and there are many good things about that, we don't necessarily have to agree upon facts anymore.
That's
right. And that is a very dangerous thing.
That is very dangerous. You're absolutely correct. I couldn't have said that one better. You know, and I noticed in that review, right, also, you know, it was rated R, and I've never seen an R rating like this before. Riots, war, sexual revolution, and a threatened punch in the face.
That should have been the tagline. Yeah,
that's good. That should have been your tagline. You know, maybe when you release it, it'll be that
I like
way.
That.
Yeah. So we're going to talk now about your most recent film, which is called The Music of Strangers. Mm-hmm. Let's watch a clip right now.
The clearest reason for music, for culture, is it gives us meaning. We started as an idea, a group of musicians getting together and seeing what might happen when strangers meet. We scoured from Venice to Istanbul, Central Asia, China, and Mongolia, looking for incredible talent.
American orchestra. That's very interesting.
This was like the Manhattan Project of music. No one knew what was going to happen.
I knew there was going to be naysayers.
You're taking this traditional music, mixing it together, and diluting these traditions.
Arts is about opening up to possibility. Possibility links to hope. We all need hope.
I'm always trying to figure out how I fit in the world, which I think is something that I share with 7 billion other people.
Since I left Syria, I found myself experiencing emotions far more complex. Like, can a piece of music stop a bullet?
1966, Cultural Revolution. My parents asked me to learn music to escape.
In Iran, the revolution, chaos. I had to leave.
By trying to kill the human spirit, the answer of the human spirit is to revenge with beauty.
I think the challenge is keeping your roots alive.
That's a new way of thinking about music, about what people can do together.
There's no East or West. It's just a globe.
We don't speak perfect English or perfect Chinese or perfect Persian, but we speak perfect music language.
Being part of this experiment make me understand what it means to be alive.
Everybody is afraid, but you make a connection to another human being. You can turn fear into joy.
So the Yo-Yo Ma called this group he assembled the Silk Road Ensemble. What was your experience when you first met Yo-Yo Ma? What was that like? Now, well, he is obviously a very world-renowned cellist. Mm-hmm.
And again, it's part of the world of music I didn't know that much about. I mean, I knew my basics of classical music and Yo-Yo, but I didn't really know who he was and where he was coming from.
Yeah.
And I had one of those classic documentarian experiences where you meet somebody and you say, oh, I could follow this guy with a camera anywhere.
Yeah.
Because he was so unexpectedly funny and smart and profane.
Right, wow.
Yeah, all things I did not expect.
Wow.
I mean, he was really just kind of a revelation for me. But more than anything, the ideas that he's been grappling with as an artist for 50 years now are the same things I grapple with, which is how does our art and our culture make the world a better place? How do we use it to do something other than just enjoy ourselves? You know, what's the value of aesthetics in that way? And I think he has been really struggling with that.
Yes.
And I think really coming up with interesting answers for that.
Yeah.
And I think the thing that I came to understand, and part of what he's trying to do with these musical exchanges and this idea of bringing together musicians of vastly different backgrounds, is very much this idea that we understand more about other people through our culture than through anything else. I mean, and by culture, I mean food and film and music. I mean,
everything.
We know more. I know more about Thailand through Thai food than I do through anything
else.
You know,
that's right.
It's a way of understanding, and I think that's his big thing. It's this idea of empathy. How do we build empathy?
Yeah.
And I think I've been thinking about the same issues. I mean, I love this Roger Ebert quote where he called movies empathy machines.
Yeah.
I think music and film can fulfill both that same purpose, which is we get to understand something of the other. We get to walk in somebody else's shoes. And they're no longer demonizable. They're not the other anymore. There's somebody who we can relate to.
You see the human and the spiritual connection.
Absolutely. You know. And you realize the commonalities in terms of what people really want and how we think about things and our common, you know, everything from our DNA to our moral structure. You know, I think music and culture just help bring all that out in a way that religion and politics and economics often do the opposite of.
That's right. You know, and I grew up as a preacher's son, so I to me, it's like music is one of those things that it's in the human experience, but it takes you to another place that's not really human.
No.
You can't, it's like consciousness or something.
Yeah.
So it becomes something that is otherworldly almost, you know, and it transforms you. And I like the way Yo-Yo Ma says, his focus is turning fear into joy. I thought, you know, and even he learned from meeting all these people from all around the world how important it is, even more than he probably originally even thought, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, and I think it's become this kind of his life's calling, in a way of trying to figure out how he can use the arts to make people understand each other. And I know that sounds very kind of Pollyanna-ish, but at the same time, he's a believer in it, and I've seen evidence of it in what he's done, in the, not just him, but the musicians who he's gathered. And it's something in America, we tend to think of the arts as nice, but non-essential.
That's right.
Like the frosting on the cake. You know, to me, really, it's the opposite. It's the culture's the plate that the cake sits on. You know,
I couldn't agree with you more, Morgan, and I thank you for saying that on this show. Let's wrap this up now. Now, you are working, I saw just recently you posted a short film called Fighting Chance. It's about three Olympic athletes training for the Rio Olympics that happened recently. And I understand you're working on a documentary about the infamous Baptist minister, children's show host, Mr. Rogers.
Yes, that's out.
Now, and you are working also on some other projects, too. You want to tell us what's going on there?
Yeah, I have some scripted projects I'm working on that are really exciting. And I'm just finishing a show about designers.
Oh, cool.
And again, it's another corner of culture that, to me, fits right into my sweet spot of kind of looking at design, which is something which is a balance of, you know, art and culture and commerce. You know, like
and
how do
all
we,
the different
you know,
ways you can do design?
Yeah, so everything from graphic design to industrial design.
Interesting.
But really, how do designers think, and how do we take apart the world and put it back together as designers? And we all design because designing is basically just decision making. So it's been really fascinating, and that's coming out next year.
That's fantastic. Well, can't wait to hear more about all these projects. And thank you so much for being on the show. Where can people learn more about you?
Follow us on Twitter. My company's Tremolo.
Tremolo, and you're
Productions.
Based in Los Angeles?
We're based in LA, and I'm based here in Pasadena. But Tremolo Docs, I think, on Twitter, and Facebook is Tremolo Productions, and we're easy to find.
Excellent.
So, yeah, thank you.
Morgan, thank you very much for being on the Now Man Show.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. This is Nice Wonder. Until next time, stay in the moment.
Very often when people perceive there to be a scene, you know, sometimes there isn't. In this case, there really was.
The Glenn Frey, and Henley was there, John Lennon.
That was the only time I met Janis Joplin.
It was the hang.
It was a hang.
The guys that turned out to be the Eagles used to be sitting right over there all the time.
You'd go in the bar and you said, everybody in show business was at that bar.
The Mecca was the Troubadour, even though there was a club called the Mecca.
By 1970, the heart of 60s rock was going down. Beatles were breaking up. The Stones were inactive. So rock and roll needed time to take its breath.
You obviously like the Rolling Stones. Let's get back to music. Mm-hmm. You did the Crossfire Hurricane. You also made this great documentary about Keith Richards. It's called Keith Richards Under the Influence. So what was it like hanging out with Keith Richards?
The thing is, what I tried to do with that documentary was to convey exactly the answer to that question. Because I feel like the film is kind of a hang with Keith Richards. Mm-hmm. And Keith is one of those people for whom having a camera there or not having a camera there doesn't change things. Mm-hmm. You know, he's kind of the same guy all the time, you know, and he's refined that for a long time. I mean, the thing I didn't know that going into it. What I did the first day, I mean, before we even knew we were gonna make a documentary, his manager, Jane Rose, who's been with him forever, said, would you come film an interview with him that we might use for this album he's working on?
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Any opportunity? Yes, absolutely. Happy to do it. And the idea I came up with is bringing in a turntable and a pile of vinyl of records that I'd curated that were things throughout his life that he would like.
Yeah.
And we spent several hours just playing records and talking about it.
Yeah.
And he loved it. Yeah. Because most of the time people want to ask him the same five questions about the Rolling Stones.
That's right.
And it was, for me, it was more, what do you want to talk about?
That's right.
Like, you want to talk about politics or history or Muddy Waters? Great. You know, and I love doing that. And so we just spun records and it kept going. And then at the end of it, they said, well, you should keep filming. So that's how it happened. It was just one of these kind of accidents. But the whole thing was not trying to be the history of Keith Richards, and he didn't want to do that. I said, let's just do what he wants to do. Let's kind of represent who Keith is today and what it's like to hang out with him.
And would you say that he, what you see is what you get on camera and off camera?
Absolutely, absolutely.
The real deal.
Yeah, like, and he's kind of no BS at this point, you know? And I'm sure he's mellowed, I'm sure he wasn't, you know, he can still be feisty, and certainly if you've read his book or follow the Stones, he could be really feisty and more difficult back in the day. But he's in such a kind of a good place now, and now he's like he's kind of become the person he always wanted to be, which is an old bluesman playing music.
That's right.
When he was a young man, he wanted to be one of those old guys sitting on a stool and playing the blues, and now he is. So.
And the Stones are working on it. Mick announced it from the stage at Desert Trip that they're working on a new album, and it's becoming an all-blues album.
I'm excited. I've been waiting for the Stones to do that for a long time. Yeah. I know that's Keith's thing. You know, I could listen to them do that all the time. And Mick is one of the great blues vocalists too. I love Mick singing.
Yeah.
And I wish he did more of that kind of singing. Yeah. So I'm excited about it.
Pearl Jam 20. So on that film, you were the producer, correct?
Yeah, so I got a call from Cameron Crowe, who, you know, I grew up reading Rolling Stone magazine and was a huge fan of, and he's told me that he was doing this Pearl Jam documentary for their 20th anniversary and needed help, and did I want to help? And I said, yeah, absolutely.
Fantastic.
And it became, you know, a couple of years of kind of tackling the subject. I mean, the great thing and the difficult thing was that they had documented everything. So there were thousands, literally thousands of hours of footage, which was great, but it took a lot of time to kind of digest it all. But it was, a kind of a great experience of learning a whole different way of working and taking you into a different direction.
That's fantastic.